receive it from the Son.
Okay. So the strangers would be giving out of obligation, right?
Right.
But the sons would be giving out of the liberality of their heart.
Out of their love, right.
Okay. But I think what Jesus is saying here, and it's interesting how Jesus will put the question back. What they're trying to entrap, that is really an entrapment.
Sure, they were
many,
trying to trick
many
him
of the questions that were asked Jesus were for entrapment. Mm-hmm. And he'd always throw a question
back to them.
And if they answer it truthfully or rightfully, he'd really be saying that the sons of the kingdom really have no obligation, but in order that there would be
no stumbling block
or
offense.
And the truth is, if you don't pay your taxes, and if you thought in your heart, and see, there are a lot of people that are anti-taxing and they believe it strong enough that they don't pay their taxes, but if you believe something strong enough,
you better be willing
to take the consequences.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
If you think abortion is wrong, you ought to go out and demonstrate in front of an abortion clinic and kill the doctor. You may say, well, boy, you know, that's what God wants me to do. He wants me to get rid of all these baby murders.
No.
Well,
offer to take care of the child.
It'd be giving one life for another life, but and I can assure you I'm as anti-abortion as you can get. But
that's not the way, right?
Yeah. But the point is, okay, so you have a strong conviction. You better be willing to pay whatever price. The disciples said what? Said that we ought to obey God rather than man. And so if it becomes a conflict between obeying God and man, we don't have any choice. But if you choose to obey God and not obey man, you may have to be willing, you will be willing, or you will be subject to
consequences.
And so you have to accept that. But this is interesting. He said the sons are free, meaning that really, technically, they shouldn't have to pay taxes. And I've had preacher friends to tell me that they would take this to be justified in
not paying taxes,
skirting their obligation to the IRS. Well, they may believe that, but they better be willing to pay a penalty and maybe go to jail if they get caught.
Yeah.
However unpleasant it may be, the duties of a citizen must be shouldered. You know, regardless of your convictions, we do have responsibilities as citizens.
Yes, sir.
We have certain responsibilities as citizens of the United States of America, and a lot of things wrong with America. But where else you want to go? Where else would you go? You want to go to Iraq?
No, thanks.
You want to go to Liberia or Libya?
I don't even want to visit there.
Okay. Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And it's amazing that this seems to be a concern of a lot of people. In fact, was it James and John, the sons of thunder?
Yeah. Sons of Zebedee.
Their mother came to Jesus and said, Lord,
set these on your right hand, right and left hand, and give them the place of honor, basically.
That's just missing the whole
point of it all.
Yeah, that's missing the whole concept. Yeah. Let one of my sons be on your right hand and the other son. Well, what have your sons done that's more worthy than some other person's son? Of course, Jesus said it's not for me to determine.
But for my Father in heaven.
Who is greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Jesus said, unless you become as a little child, you're not even.
That's the greatest.
Yeah. To be a citizen of the kingdom, you had to completely forget about self.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Let's take a look at some of the characteristics of children. they may be fighting 1 minute, but make up and play the next minute.
Yeah.
They forgive and they forget. But we have a tendency to what? Remember.
Remember and hold grudges.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Another characteristic of a child is they're still young, they're flexible, they're pliable, which says that we're going to have to be as little children. We're going to have to be
the same way.
Pliable, flexible, not being set in our ways, not being the old wineskins, you know, desiring to have the new wine poured in. Humility. Now, you have some what I call bratty kids, and you have some kids that, if you're not careful and if you don't really know what the root of the problem is, sometimes you can almost despise. You can certainly despise what the kid is doing, and it just absolutely amazes me to see how kids act out in public and the parents let them get away with it.
And yeah, that's who you really want to get on as a parent.
But one of the characteristics of a child is that they have a spirit of humility. Kids, as a general rule, don't have the inbred sense of superiority. That's all taught. They're dependent. You know, we were talking about the principles, the seven habits of highly effective people. One of the things that Stephen Covey brings out is that we're not to be dependent. Well, we're to always be dependent on God, but we need to come to the place that we're not dependent upon others, and we can't take a position of independence. But he uses a term that he calls interdependence, meaning that there is a mutual dependency upon one another, that we, it's not like one is superior and is being responsible for the well-being of another. But as children of the kingdom, we should learn what it means to trust the Heavenly Father, to depend upon the Heavenly Father. He who receives a little child receives me, and how did I slip that in there? Okay, I must have. Okay.
Whoever receives a little child in my name receives
okay.
me.
Okay, and I jumped ahead there some way. Prejudice and bias, discrimination is not inbred. Or it's not indoor.
No. Uh-huh.
Kids are not prejudiced. They're taught to be prejudiced, and they can learn to be prejudiced at a very early age. But the characteristic of a child basically is no prejudice, no bias.
If left to themselves, they could care less.
Exactly. They don't consider whether a kid has certain color skin. And that's the reason why I say that we're not where we ought to be in racial relationships in this country. But I think we would be ignorant to say that we haven't made a lot of improvements the last 50 years. And one thing that we can say is, as a general rule, the younger generation has been more accepting than the older generation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he who receives a little child receives me. Better have a millstone tied around your neck and be cast into the sea than to offend one of these little ones. Now let me bring out something very interesting here also. You have to keep in mind that Jesus brought honor and respect to those who had the least respect
before,
in that culture.
Right.
Namely,
women and
children. Slaves, right? He identified with the poor. He identified with the oppressed. So what he's really doing is he's giving honor and respect to this little child. And he says that it's better if you'd have a millstone tied around your neck and be cast into the depths of the sea than to fend one of these little ones. And yeah, that can be, that can certainly be taken, well, that is to be taken spiritually. Offense is a spiritual thing, isn't it? You can take offense spiritually. I guess you could take it physically also. All right. The procedure that you go through is a three-step procedure if your brother sins against you. Now, I'm assuming that this is the fact that you yourself have recognized that somebody has sinned against you or has an offense toward you. The first thing you do is go to him or her personally and tell them of their error. What is the general response of people that if somebody came and pointed out to them that they had offended you? What is the general human response? If I came to Burby and I said, Burby, you've offended me. Now, if he were a true brother with a true heart of purity and wanted to do what is right, and if he valued our friendship, he'd be very concerned, and he would say, look, said, I'm just putting words in your mouth here. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I believe he would.
You would say, look, I didn't realize.
I didn't mean to.
I didn't mean to. You know, I didn't intend any harm. Now, if you had intended harm and you were accused of it, chances are you're going to be defensive, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to say, hey, man, you're wrong. All right. But if you have the true spirit of humility and really value a friendship, when somebody tells you, whether you did it or not, or whether you didn't know that you did it, what are you going to basically say? Well, I wasn't aware of it, or... Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we can do things in a joking way and in a playful way
people take wrongly,
right? Now, there are people that will say, if I think there are some people who have the evil intent of doing harm to someone, then if it brought their attention, they say, oh, I was just playing. But they meant to hurt you. Mm-hmm. Now, if he listens, maybe you gained a brother, but I would think probably that you could say what? That you have retained a brother or you have regained a brother. I'm assuming that if your brother sins against you and you go to him, that he's already your brother, right? But you have restored a fractured relationship. Now, if he doesn't listen, you take one or two as witnesses. And if he refuses, you tell it to the church. If they refuse to hear the church, let him be to you as a Gentile or a tax collector. Now, here's an interesting point. How many understand that to be called a Gentile or to be recognized as a tax collector would have been having a curse on you? You know, as far as the Jewish people were concerned, the worst thing you could call them would be a Gentile. Or for you to associate them with a tax collector. But here's a good point. How many understand that Jesus loved the Gentiles and he was willing to die for them and he was willing to accept them? He also was willing to accept the outcast tax collectors. So guess what? If you go to your brother, he refuses to listen to you, you take two or three witnesses, they refuse to listen, one or two witnesses, they refuse to listen to you, you take it to the church, they refuse to listen to you, you think God's going to throw you away?
No.
No. Again, you may be treated as a Gentile or a tax collector.
But But Jesus still loves them.
Jesus loves the Gentiles and the tax collectors, and he's going to be there to restore you.
Absolutely.
How often do you forgive? Well, was it Peter that came up with it seven times?
Yeah, it was.
Okay.
And by their lights, by the culture, even the religious culture.
They didn't go that far.
That was
very generous.
To his mind, extremely generous. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and he came up with this good spiritual number seven, didn't he?
Yeah, complete forgiveness.
But the rabbis allowed only two forgivenesses. In fact, I have been told, and I've heard this about all my life, that Jewish people come to each other's rescue. That they will help a struggling brother, say like in business. They will help to bail that brother out. And my understanding is they get two chances. Third time you strike out.
You're on your own.
So the rabbis allowed two forgivenesses. Well, how good. How great. They do what? They smite you on one cheek and then
turn the other. Smite once you hit cheek, that other, it's on.
Then after that, anything goes. But of course, Jesus said what? What was his response?
No, 70 times 7.
Okay, not 7 times, but 70 times 7. And we've talked about this. What does that mean? Does that mean literally 490 times? Or does that have some spiritual?
I think it's more of a spiritual nature.
And what would be the spiritual nature of it?
Complete forgiveness.
Complete. I mean, 7 times 70? That's complete forgiveness.
And you give forgiveness as long as it's needed.
And I say that because, look, if you forgive somebody 490 times a day,
they've been pretty busy on you.
Are you going to cut them off after
that 491st
time?
Ooh.
No.
Wasn't 490 years from the book of Malachi to when?
490 years?
From the book of Malachi to when Jesus or the Father spoke to Jesus when he was baptized.
Okay, it was about 400 years. Yeah, 400 years. And the 490 years would be Daniel's 70 weeks. Yeah, that was Daniel. But historically, a period of time between the Old Testament prophet Malachi and the New Testament prophets it's what we call the four silent centuries, where really
nothing
we don't have any recording.
That's not any
record,
happened.
Not to say anything happened, but we don't have any record of God speaking
to man.
To man. And there's no written record. Now, there were a lot of things written, but nothing that was written in that 400-year period that was ever considered to be canonical, met the standard of the Holy Canon.
What's that called? Is that the
not the apocalypse, but apocalypse is the revealing, but it's the, it's late.
Apocrypha.
The Apocrypha.
The Dead Sea Scrolls and things
the
like
Apocrypha.
That.
The Apocrypha. The Apocrypha are inspirational, well, in the truest sense of the word, anything that is inspired is God breathed. And we talk about, somebody being an inspirational speaker. We usually think about them as being motivating, right? Being excited, interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But in the truest sense, if you're talking about somebody being an inspirational speaker, you're talking about them speaking by inspiration of the Holy Ghost. But you had a lot of writings, and some of the writings were very good writing. In other words, they were good literature. They were good literary books, in one sense of the word. And there are some that are considered more of a gem than others. And I think, what is the Book of Susanna or something like that?
Yeah,
it,
there were several of them. I can't remember. I read a little bit out of some of them, and some of the stuff is actually pretty good.
Yeah. there's a book called the Lost Books of the Bible and the Books of Eden. The Lost Books of the Bible and the Books of Eden. And one of those books, I had a copy of that one a long time, I don't know what happened to it. But one of these books in the Lost Books tells about Jesus as a little boy that would make birds out of mud.
And yeah,
throw them up in the air, and they would fly.
Yeah.
And then it would
be
about healing of other little kids. But here's a kicker. They also say that like if some little kid mistreated him, he would strike him blind or something, you know.
That just
first of all, that just smacks in the face of the sinless one. But it also smacks in the face of the fact that Jesus did not really come to the identification of who he really was until baptism in Jordan.
Well,
when God spoke and said, "Thou art my beloved son." Mm-hmm. See, he was talking to Jesus. He was recognizing Jesus as his son. Then, of course, on the Mount of Transfiguration, he said, "This is my beloved son." He was addressing Peter, James, and John, bringing attention to the fact that Jesus was.
But at Jordan, he was talking to
Jesus. He's talking to Jesus. Exactly. So, Jesus spent a lifetime, 30 years, in preparation for the revealing or being, to be brought forth. Spent 30 years in preparation, and the scripture says that he grew in wisdom and stature both with God and with man. Okay, he grew. When Jesus came into the flesh, he emptied himself. That's the reason why the scripture said that he humbled himself, became a servant, even to the point of dying, and to the point of being offered up in death. But God then what? Highly exalted him and gave him a name that's above every name. Then the story of the servant who was forgiven but refused to forgive. This is interesting. You know, I've heard numbers. I don't have any idea what a pound was worth. In England, a pound's worth about, $2.2 or something like that? He was forgiven 2,400,000 pounds. And I guess that was translated, from... And he refused to forgive someone of 5 pounds. Look at that. Was forgiven 2,400,000 and he refused to forgive 5. So how could you expect forgiveness? See, there's a law of reciprocity that says what? Given it shall be given.
Pressed down, shaken together
shall men give unto your bosom. And that is speaking about mercy, right?
Mercy, right, more than money.
Whatever man sows, he
shall reap.
You sow love, you reap love.
Sow mercy, you reap mercy.
Yeah. So that's the law of reciprocity. So, if you sow unforgiveness, guess what you'll reap? Unforgiveness.
Exactly.
How cool.
You did it.
Finished in an hour and 7 or 8 minutes.
You did it.
We've done that 2 weeks in a row, haven't we?
Wow.
But that doesn't mean we're going to necessarily start late next time, so we can cut it short. Okay, that's all for tonight.
We'll spend more time on it next week.
Yeah. So we will see y'all hopefully, I guess, tomorrow night and Thursday night. And
yes, sir.
Whenever. Okay, God bless you.
I got one.